In the past couple of videos, we would develop some basic concepts we'll be using in this course. But before we can go on to actual circuits, we need to add a few more pieces to our vocabulary. Last time we looked at resistors. Resistors are one of the basic circuit elements. Circuit elements are simply the components that we put into our circuit. We also, out of necessity, used a generic DC voltage source to introduce Ohm's law. However, if generic DC voltage sources were the only thing we could connect to a circuit, electronics would be very, very boring. So what types of sources are there? The answer is a lot of different types, but generally we would put them into a few categories. The generic DC voltage source is an example of an independent voltage source. An independent voltage source is one that outputs the same voltage, regardless of what is connected to it. The circuit symbols we will use to represent an independent DC voltage source, that is, a voltage source that supplies a constant voltage regardless of what is connected to it, will take one of two forms. Either a circle with a polarity indicated as on the left, or a series of alternating length lines generally used to indicate a battery. There are also independent AC or alternating current voltage sources. Like all independent sources, their output is not affected by what is connected to them. Unlike DC sources, however, the voltage they output is not constant in time. The voltage signals may take the form of a sinusoid, a ramp wave, triangle wave, square-ish wave, or some other time-varying signal. The circuit symbols we will use to represent AC voltage sources look similar to the generic voltage source, but in the center of the symbol, there's a squiggle or a wave. There's also such a thing as an independent current source. That is a source that outputs a constant current, regardless of the circuit surrounding it. In this course, we'll use one symbol for both AC and DC current sources. Differentiating between AC and DC signals will be done by the designation next to the source. The convention that we will use is a capital I with a capital subscript will designate DC, while a lowercase I followed by a lowercase subscript will designate an AC current. This convention of upper and lowercase letters for variables and subscripts will be used throughout the course. Before I go on to other types of sources, I want to point out that what we're talking about is circuit modeling. What that means is we're trying to come up with a mathematical description of how a circuit will behave. Most of the time, we're dealing with a circuit that will operate under a certain range of conditions. Because of this, we can come up with a representation that closely approximates the actual behavior of the circuit. All that being said, while resistors have a linear, for the most part, relationship between voltage and current, there are many devices that do not have linear characteristics. Among the nonlinear devices are some of the most common devices in use today, transistors. There are many types of transistors, all of which have complex current-voltage relationships. However, we can model them as linear devices if we introduce some things called dependent sources. These are sources that have an output that is dependent upon some other parameter in the circuit, such as voltage or current. This is a simple model of a bipolar junction transistor. We'll learn more about the transistor later, but for now, it illustrates how a dependent source is used and works in a circuit. Here, the dependent source is a current-controlled current source. The amount of current the source provides is a constant, beta, times the current, IB, that enters on the other side. So the current from the source is controlled by a current in the same component. So we have dependent sources, and they are used to model devices that we use in real life. These are not just academic devices of torture. Now, since we have voltage and current sources that can be controlled by either a current or a voltage, there are four types of controlled sources. We already have the current-controlled current source. We could also have a voltage-controlled current source, a voltage-controlled voltage source, or a current-controlled voltage source. There. We have all the sources we're going to use in this series. Now for the rest of our vocabulary lesson. Let's draw an electrical circuit. I'll start with a single resistor. If you remember, I've already told you that a resistor is an example of a circuit element. When we put this in a circuit, we also call it a branch. One circuit element isn't very fun, so let's add a second resistor. These resistors are connected by using a wire, which, for purposes of this class, has no resistance. In fact, this is almost always the case in any project you'll do in the laboratory. Standard 24 gauge wire used for laboratory projects has about 26 milliohms of resistance per foot. Unless you have an expensive meter, you cannot even measure that small of a resistance. This amount of resistance is negligible and will not affect your circuit. Since the wire has no resistance, the entire connection between the two components is a single node. If we were to add a third component connected to the other two by a wire, there's still a single node in the circuit. If we add a few more components, all connected to each other by wires, we can look at the circuit and identify four distinct points that are connections. So there are four nodes in the circuit. Correctly identifying nodes is very important for several different concepts. So in introductory courses, I encourage students to highlight or outline the wires so there's no confusion in recognizing the nodes. Simply highlight along the wire until you come to a component and continue until the whole wire is highlighted. The last piece we need is the piece that is necessary to have an actual circuit. If we start at any point or node in the circuit and go around the circuit through the branches and wires, when we get back to the point we started at, we have completed a loop. Until the loop is closed, we don't actually have a circuit. Now, even a simple circuit like this one has several loops, as a loop is any closed path in the circuit. We have another one here, and another one here, a bigger loop here, and one that goes around the entire outside. We also have a couple of loops that have a bit of an odd shape, but they are complete paths that end up at the same node, so they are loops too. So there you have it. With that, we can move on to looking at some actual circuits next time. In this video, we covered independent voltage and current sources, dependent voltage and current sources that are used to model things like transistors, and we covered some language about the circuit. We identified circuit elements as branches, connections between two or more branches were called nodes, and complete paths through branches and wires were called loops. That's all for today. Until next time, make it a great one.